Friday, 26th of June, 2009. Morning work at Borrowdale Park. Turning out Lisa Harris and her team, the biggest and most successful yard in Zimbabwe. Reigning champion Lisa Harris has topped the trainer log for five of the last six seasons. Across the road, Glenwood Racing, the stable of Nolene Peach, twice champion trainer in 2002 and 2003, respectively. One of the smaller yards, with a string of just 17 horses, is trainer Daniel Chimbamba. Back home from Johannesburg, riding for the Kirk Swanson yard is local jockey Kevin Durere. Kirk Swanson took the trainer championship in 2005. One of many grooms in attendance is Kasten Bakasa, veteran of some 58 years, and present at the very first race meeting held at Borrowdale Park back in 1958. Big or small, old and young, for the Zimbabwe horse racing fraternity, the final countdown has begun. It's the Borrowdale Park Golden Jubilee weekend. Culminating in an eight-race card with total stakes of $50,000, the Jubilee is a celebration of 117 years of thoroughbred horse racing in Zimbabwe and 51 years of horse racing at Borrowdale Park. It is also a celebration of survival, a symbol of achievement and ultimate triumph in the face of tremendous adversity. For many, battered but not defeated, from a decade of a country under siege, the Golden Jubilee achievement stands as a symbol of hope and real possibility, heralding the prospect of a new dawn for the people of Zimbabwe.
It's very significant, partly because I don't think many of us who left in racing, breeding, owning, training at the moment would have dreamt 5 years ago that we could still be standing. And I must say, at a number of times over the last few years, it's looked as though the Mashonaland Turf Club couldn't survive the onslaught. But it's kept going, and the significance of getting to this milestone is that people have pulled together, showing that there is enormous resilience in the engine of racing. And I think the objective of showing that Zimbabwe racing is alive and healthy, very well organized in Zimbabwe today, will be achieved.
Reflecting the past and anticipating the future, it's a weekend filled with nostalgia and expectation.
The first meeting, 14th of July 1958, 128 horses raced that day in nine races, which is a bit more than the 81 who are racing on Sunday. The first race was won by Tower Bridge. Stanley Eden was the rider, Boss Lilford was the owner, and the groom, Kasten Bakasa, is still working here at Borrowdale Park 51 years later. He now works for Kirk Swanson. I don't think he's here tonight, but it would be nice to give him a shout. Ginger Halfpenny, you rode that first meeting. Ginger, you're still with us. Sometimes I'm amazed.
On the big day, reigning champion Lisa Harris takes four winners on the card. Nolene Peach takes two. The Kirk Swanson-Kevin Durere combination take the remaining two with a double in the sixth and seventh. Daniel Chimbamba and the smaller yards, after a game showing, come away empty-handed. But with racing, there's always a next time, and they'll be back to fight another day. Veteran groom Kasten Bakasa gets a special award for 58 years service to the Zimbabwe racing industry.
I remember being at Churchill School in my blazer and tie and being told to go to the school hall at 12 o'clock to be told that the country had declared UDI. I had no idea what that was. I thought it was running in the fourth at Borrowdale on Saturday. We've been through such amazing times, and many people, including myself, moved out of the country to try and seek new pastures. But somehow, the roots always lie so deep. You're not a Zimbabwean. Zimbabwean is actually born in you. And you can't escape it no matter where you go to. at heart, we still remain Zimbabweans. This is our country. It always will be, no matter where we go. It's who we are. It's from the past, from where we've come, and it helps us to understand where we're going.
In Zimbabwe, the past is a turbulent and violent one. Conquest, oppression, racial prejudice, bush war, liberation, dictatorship have all defined and shaped the Zimbabwe of today. None come through unscathed. Memories are bittersweet. Daniel Chimbamba, the only black trainer in Zimbabwe, started off as a groom in the late 1960s. Every morning he inspects his string of 17 horses, saddles up the grooms and makes for the track. While most set out in double cabs and 4x4s, Daniel Chimbamba enjoys the walk across the Borrowdale track to the ring. It's been a long, hard road, but not without special moments. As a groom, his sweetest memory is of the time he accompanied Zimbabwe's centre court to the Durban July Handicap in 1970.
Yeah, I still remember when I was looking after horses. Well, I loved that thing. I was a lucky person. I used to look after good horses. When I was a groom, I looked after the other horse, which is known as centre court. He ran in the July Handicap from a trainer from here, and he ran a very tremendous race, very good race. He ran third in the July Handicap.
Daniel's big break came in 1986. The late owner-trainer Benny Lobel recognized his talent. In spite of the status quo, Benny Lobel took a stand and supported Daniel in his struggle to become a registered trainer.
Now, at that time, it was hard, as you know, blacks, you know, couldn't be allowed to train horses. He started this with the late George Eze. They were together. They all said, it's a good guy, this one. He must train horses. And George Eze said, otherwise, he might help me in South Africa to do that. So he tried in South Africa. They said, no. Can't happen. They weren't the black trainers in South Africa. I said, no, we don't like that. Stop that. We don't like to hear it.
But Benny Lobel was determined and got Daniel an interview with Academy Master Desi Fisher.
When I saw him, he said, well, what do you know about horses? Just I told him, well, I've been a groom for a long time and know everything about a horse, and what I want to do is to be a trainer. Because where are you going? And he said, where are you going to get the horses from? I said, Mr. Benny Lobel is going to give me the horses to train. He said, well, we can try you. Better sit down and we give you a test now. And I said, well, I can't get a test now before I have got the rule book. And he said, well, you're all right, I can give you a rule book. He said, how long are you going to do this? And I tried to open the rule book. I said, this will take me 3 months. Start and write and do everything. Then I had to stay for a 3 month, and from that time I came to him again and said, now I'm sure I'm ready to get the test. He gave me the test, and lucky enough I got passed with 75%, which was, he said, well, it's okay. From that time, and I had to tell Mr. Lobo, he said, right, he gave me horses at that time. That was in 1986 when I took the license.
Benny Lobel passed away 3 years later in 1989. With his death, Daniel Chimbamba's career as a trainer came to an end. In the years that followed, he worked as an assistant to a number of trainers, including Murray Lindley. In 1995, tragedy struck when Murray Lindley and his wife Sally were killed in the Bromley air disaster, which also took the lives of Paul Muscott, Gordon White, and Ian Sanderman. Daniel Chimbamba was once again in the wilderness. 15 years after independence, and black trainers were still not a welcome prospect in the elitist ranks of the Zimbabwe horse racing fraternity.
I used to have a hard time, really, because also those trainers and the owners, you know, they weren't much interesting to see a black trainer. I can still remember one of the trainers, but he left, he's now in South Africa. He said to me, I'm not going to stay here just because you are an opposition leader. And that puzzled my brain. I said, how can it be, how can you talk like that? He said, yeah, I'm talking like that. And he said, well, it's all up to you. Then he left the country. He went to South Africa. The trainers are okay. I don't blame them much. But the owners, you know, they are one-way supporters. You see, they don't need to support people like black people to give them horses. That's where the problem is. See, I don't have much support from the white people because the majority of the people here, the owners, are white people, and they support one way. They need their own way. That's where. Otherwise, that's where the only difference is. Otherwise, we can call it blood is thicker than water. Then the thing is, this black person named Mr. Brian Makwabarara, well, he also decided to support me, which is a good, and I'm doing very well. He's also doing very well for me. At present, with 17 horses, I'm sure it's quite all right. At all the time, what I only wanted is to which I couldn't get, is to get horses from other people.
The land redistribution program was blueprinted in the Lancaster House Agreement with independence in 1980. By 1990, only 40% of targeted redistribution had been reached. In 2000, the issue came to a head when a referendum on a new constitution was narrowly defeated. Had it been approved, the new constitution would have enabled government to take land at its discretion without compensation. Days after the defeat, the War Veterans Association mobilized their cohorts to march on white-owned farms. Lawless invasion and seizure ensued.
That's being political now. But, you know, some you win, some you lose. It's unfortunate that the land distribution is seen as if land grabbing and so forth. No. It's trying to correct the colonial injustice which was there. And I think to those who have had their horses, most of them have remained, they have maintained their horses, and I'm sure it will continue like that. That's why the industry has survived.
I've managed to survive on this stud because I'm in Harare Center. The guys who were in rural areas didn't survive because their farms were taken. That, I think, is the long and the short of it. If you were in a reasonably protected area as a breeder, you could survive, but if you were very rural, you couldn't.
My brother was, he was kicked off his farm, which was a major blow to him because he was a top farmer. My mother and father left by choice because they were the only people left in the district.
Basically, we had a few problems for a few years, but 2004, we were given the day to get off. 3 months prior to us moving off, we knew it was going to happen. So they basically moved everything out of the house, and they were living in a shell, really. I think they were just waiting till the order came. So when the time came, they were prepared. They just moved off and did what they had to do with the animals, and yeah, carried on.
You've got to understand, in Zimbabwe until very recently, it was very difficult to even want to be here. A real tenacity comes through, and again, I was wrong. I didn't even mention the grooms. The grooms have struggled big time here.
The grooms that I've got working here, they battled more than we did with what happened, because they starved and they were hungry and they were cold, and you know, they battled more than the people who had a roof over their head.
Amidst all this trauma, the violence, looming anarchy and lawlessness, in 1998 on Golden Acres Stud Farm, a star was born. When the dam Carne de Danse gave birth, here in this humble stable, to the filly Ipitombi.
If you told me it was born normal fashion, she was one of many yearlings we had on the farm. I think there was a consignment of about 55 yearlings. A nice group of yearlings, but we had our interruptions at that stage. We had like groups coming on, chasing the horses, taking the poles down in the paddocks, so the horses getting loose. I mean, that group of horses at one stage, they took down 20 odd poles in the paddock and they got out one night. It took us 3 days to find them all. Some of them had gone about 20 k's out onto the roads, and it was terrible. So how she survived, I don't know. We found her after the second day. She was very footsore, had been running for, I don't know how, for hours. She was a very plain little bay filly that just was, there was nothing special about her, but she, even in the paddock, she didn't show speed, she was always one that looked after herself. But she must have had such a big heart inside there, for even to survive and get there was a major, major thing in those days.
I had Ipitombi from the start of her career until she left for South Africa.
A length or so behind that, we find Holly's paired with Ipitombi going straight.
She was a very ordinary, uncomplicated, genuine horse. And she just, everything she did, she ate well, she slept well, she worked well. It wasn't until we started racing her that she actually had a joy in her step.
Ipitombi going to the wire. Ipitombi gets the better of Jess Jasmine.
First time out, Ipitombi easily broke her maiden at Borrowdale Park. 6 months later, with four wins under her belt, she took her first feature in South Africa with the SA Phillies Classic at Newmarket.
The one doing the chasing, but Ipitombi is there, and he's going to win it for Zimbabwe. Ipitombi wins by three.
From then on, she remained unbeaten. In 2002, Ipitombi took the Durban July Handicap.
And Angus running a big race along the inside. American Badger, Delta Grove, Flight Alert beaten. Kia Destiny, Fiery Thread, Angus on the inside. Kia Destiny, Angus is getting closer. Ipitombi's flying from nowhere. Kia Destiny, Ipitombi. Ipitombi, I believe, won the July.
That was a surreal moment. I mean, to see that little filly come, you know, a huge team effort, Kay-Shay to lose that much weight and come back under the brilliance of de Kock. Yeah, it was awesome. Very emotional, but yeah, very special. Special for the country, special for so many people who really, really needed something to hold on to at that time.
Ready to go with Terry Spindle.
Up and racing.
She went on to great things, of course. She went on to Dubai and became one of the most respected fillies in the world, and to today is still one of the most respected broodmares in the world.
Ipitombi takes the lead, 100 metres left to go. It's Ipitombi in front, drawing clear of Paolini, and Ipitombi beat Paolini.
We have been through a very tough time in the breeding industry. I've been, in the last 10 years, the chairman of the Thoroughbred Breeders Association, and we had, 7 or 8 years ago, we had 35 breeders in Zimbabwe. Today we're down to, I think, 8 or 9. So we're a depleted mob, and I am surprised at the resilience of those who've managed to keep the industry going. It's been uphill for a number of years, actually ever since 2000. But I'm pleased to say that we've just had our national yearling sales and we seem to have touched the bottom and we're on the way up.
Two recent developments have brought a tangible sense of optimism to Zimbabwe. The first is the formation of a government of national unity, bringing with it the prospect of peace, stability, justice and the rule of law. The second is the US dollarization of the Zimbabwe economy.
My husband and I lived in the UK for 3 years and we loved it, but it's not the same. And we were happy to be back and I don't think we'd ever leave. Love it here. I think it can only get better. I hope so. I'm hoping we've been through the worst. We're all just hoping it does get better. So I could want nothing better for my daughter.
I always say I wouldn't change the lifestyle I have for the world, because it is, although we're faced with lots of difficulties, it's quite easy to live here. You know, the staff are pleasant, they, you know, friendly, helpful people. I don't feel worried if I leave my children at home with a maid, or it's easy to get to the school, it's, you know, 10 minutes from here. So, and we don't have the traffic problems that you face in other parts of the world. So, yeah, it's not a problem, it's easy.
There's a huge community. I mean, so many young people live here, they've got their kids. And they, you know, they love it. It's easy, the weather's nice, your kids can go out and play. In terms of schools, there's some great schools. I wouldn't think about sending my little girl anywhere else.
And what of the future for the thoroughbred horse racing industry in particular? Do the authorities in any way regard horse racing as an indulgent, elitist hangover from the colonial past?
There's nothing like that. We are in Zimbabwe and horse racing has survived. You see, there are a lot of things which used to happen in the past. If they are good, they are good. And I want to believe that Borrowdale or horse racing in Zimbabwe will continue to function successfully, because it is in the interest of not only the punters or the owners, but the nation as a whole. At least you have an occasion where all people will come in and forget whatever is happening outside there and share this piece of joy. Even His Excellency loves to come to Borrowdale, and he enjoys watching race. There is, of course, on our card we have the President's Cup.
There is the term that racing is the sport of kings. So from that aspect, they see it as elitist. But from another point of view of gaming, or from the other point of the torch, they actually see us, one, is offering employment, and for government itself, they also see it as a source of revenue. Because out of the turnovers that we get, lotteries and gaming board get a percentage, and also government gets money in terms of VAT. So, and also another addition in terms of VAT, we offer employment. The industry itself employs in excess of 6,000 people.
And given its painful history, what chance of reconciliation to enable a prosperous future?
You know, my parents are retired now and they have a lovely property in Borrowdale, so they're very happy and they're very supportive of the stable. Yeah, my brother, he's just got on with it. I think we're a lot more optimistic now than we were a year ago. A year ago, we were really feeling jeepers. I think we've wasted our time, but we're more optimistic here.
She's happy. She's got her kids, her grandchildren. No, she's very pleased. I think it's quite hard not being on the farm and not having the space they used to, but they're very happy.
Look, I think a lot of people do harbour bitterness, especially the farmers that were very successful and you know, were given 24 hours to leave their farms. But, you know, I feel living in this country, you can't dwell on that sort of thing. If you, wherever you are, you can get dished out a bad blow and you've just actually got to deal with it. It's all about being positive and having a positive attitude towards life.
Yes, I think there is sufficient goodwill. Racing, of course, as is well understood, has been predominantly a white sport in this country. The Turf Club over many years has done a very great deal to integrate it as a multi-racial sport. But by and large, owners of horses have not been black people. I don't think that is going to make any difference. We have enormous goodwill in all spheres of racing. The president of this country is the main patron of the Mashonaland Turf Club, for example, and has often come racing at Borrowdale Park. In fact, we had a race named for the president in the form of the Independence Trophy, which has been running for at least 25 years. I think the goodwill is there. I think nobody in this country at any level minds that racing goes on and goes forward and prospers. Apart from anything else, it provides huge employment through the knock-on industries, and a good sport, and major revenue to government.
In Zimbabwe, the future is in the hands of all, both black and white, inextricably bound together in a common destiny. Already the examples are many, but on Jubilee Day, it's in the sixth race double. Up from Johannesburg, engaged to ride for the Kirk Swanson Yard, jockey Kevin Durere takes time out to visit his family, who, in spite of independence, still live in a three-roomed house in the township outside Harare, where Kevin was born. Kevin's father, Prince, fought in the liberation struggle for Zimbabwe's hard-won independence.
I was in the army for 5-6 years. Yeah, 5-6 years. Specializing in landmines and bombs.
29 years on, for him and his family, very little has changed, and he is today unemployed. Kirk Swanson's family was one of those who lost their farm during the notorious land invasions. Unable to continue farming, picking up the pieces of his life, Kirk worked as an assistant trainer to Nolene Peach. In August 2003, he started his own yard, and a year later was champion trainer for the 2004-2005 season. Brought together by a common destiny that is Zimbabwe today, this unlikely partnership on Golden Jubilee Day reflects the possibility of a future of reconciliation and prosperity for all in Zimbabwe.
Everything that's happened in the past has had an effect on all of us, and whatever your perspective is or which side of the fence you may swing, it's affected every single one of us. Like the rules of the jockey club, we're bound by the rules of the country, and like happens in the country as a whole, we all struggle against adversity. We're all liable to create meticulous planning to try and get to our success, and we have to make an extraordinary effort, and we have to endure and persevere. Ultimately, when you hit that winning post, it's the sweet smell of success. And I can't help but feel, coming back to this country after so many times over all these years, I can't help but feel that we're nearing the winning post in this country now. We're about the 200-meter mark. We need to pull out the stick and put the blinkers on, maybe a citation bit, but we will get there. And from then onwards, I'm hoping that we'll all be in the winner's circle.
I'm optimistic that with the resolution of the political environment that we are in, the leaders of the political parties formed a government of national unity, and within a short period of time, with the constitutional process having been finalized, I see us returning to normality. I see us having international connections. We are a global village. We are not just a Zimbabwe. We'll be a Zimbabwe with friends from other countries, and I'm optimistic with that stability we should then actually see the industry coming back to its normal.
May I tell you, the future is bright. I'm mainly speaking from the bottom of my heart, not necessarily representing anybody. I would like this institution to continue, because as I've said, it brings all races together. It is an occasion where people will forget and they will celebrate joy. So there is future, and we as Zimbabweans are determined to make sure that it survives.
I am very positive. I think that we are going to come right, and that's why I'm here. I want to bring up another Epitombi. That's my dream again. And I think we can do it.